He is now Governor-elect Matt Bevin after his decisive victory over Attorney General Jack Conway in the November 3rd election. He's the first governor from Louisville in a century and only the third Republican-elected governor in the last half century. The Lieutenant Governor-elect Janine Hampton is the first African-American to win any statewide office. Bevin is expected to make appointments this week and is setting an agenda to start working on when he is sworn in on December 8th. Matthew Griswold Bevin is our guest tonight on Issues and Answers, the Mountain Edition.
Issues and Answers, the Mountain Edition is sponsored by the City of Hazard. Come home to the mountains.
Governor-elect Matt Bevin with us tonight. Matt, thank you for coming down to Hazard today.
Very, very welcome. Good to be here.
Well, my first question is, how did you get your middle name?
It is funny. I'm one of those people blessed with two last names. It's a last name.
Okay.
And it was my grandfather's middle name, and it was his grandfather's middle name. So for some period of time, a couple hundred years now, every other generation, someone gets it as a middle name. And at some point, a couple hundred years ago, it came into the family in the 1700s as a middle name. And somebody must have married into the Griswold family at some point. So
that is one thing I learned on election night when your lieutenant governor announced you. His middle name's Griswold.
Well, when I was a kid, it didn't even resonate with people until Family Vacation, those movies came out. Then up until that point, people just thought it was kind of interesting. And then it was forever linked to Clark.
There you go.
And the family truckster.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about election night. You always said you expected to win. Were you surprised by your margin of victory?
I was not. I always believed I would win by 4-6%. I truly believed that right up until the very end. The margin was higher than that. I was less surprised by the margin of victory than I was by the uniformity of it. The fact that we won 106 out of 120 counties was remarkable to me. It's unprecedented, and to me, it sends a powerful message. And that, I think, surprised me more than anything else. I see it, and we talked about this earlier, but I see that as a cry for help. I think the people of Kentucky are demanding to be heard. They're scared, they're nervous, they're worried, and they have reason to be on many fronts. And so I look at that map, and I look at the amount of red on it. I look at the counties that we were able to win that are heavy, heavy Democrat counties, and yet they were willing to take a risk on someone like me. I take that very seriously. I don't take this for granted at all. And I intend to govern in a way that will honor the commitment people made at the ballot box.
Well, you obviously have a short time before the inauguration. Can you tell me anything about the cabinet you're selecting? And will there be any Eastern Kentuckians in your administration?
There are. I can't get too far ahead of myself because in some measure, not only did I promise nothing along the way, literally, not a single appointment, not a single expectation on the night that we won from anybody, and that's good. But I also have to be thoughtful because it's important that I surround myself with the right kind of people. What to expect? Expect people who have experience. Expect people who have, on average, as much gray hair as I do. People who bring to the equation the things that are going to contribute to solutions. I'm looking for three specific things. I'm looking for people with character. I'm looking for people with competence. And I'm looking for people with a commitment to Kentucky. The three C's, I didn't intend them to be C's until I actually was winnowing this down and realized that's what they are. Character, actual competence, and then commitment to being a truly public servant, serving the public above themselves. This is what I'm looking for, and I'm talking with and expect that I'll have people from east, west, and in between.
And you're going to start making those announcements this week?
We will. I'm going to start with my general counsel. That announcement I would expect in the next day or two, followed probably most likely by my chief of staff, and then they will fall in order after that.
It was announced this morning that Mac Brown is the new chairman of the Republican Party. He's also chairman of your transition team. A lot of folks may not know a lot about Mac. What can you tell us about him?
Mac is just a wonderful man. I mean, a very experienced executive with the Brown Foreman Company, a man who just has a graciousness and a diplomacy. He's wise. He's thoughtful. He's mature. He's retiring, actually, from his private sector world, but he's always been committed to conservative principles and committed to the state of Kentucky, and that's exactly the kind of person we need more of in government.
You said last week one of your first actions will be to sign an executive order to remove the names of county clerks from marriage licenses. Why is that so important to you?
It just cleans up a lot of noise and a lot of static. I mean, so much of the hullabaloo that came about in recent months came about as a result of the fact that a simple solution like this was not put forward. I put out a press release on July the 10th asking for exactly this. Take the names off, make it a downloadable form, make it able to be picked up in hard copy. Allow these forms to then be filed with a county clerk, just like a deed, like a lien, like a mortgage, like any other legal document. That would have fixed all of this. It's what should have been done. It's what I'll do. It'll remove this burden from those other clerks as well. 57 clerks out of 120 asked our current governor for this, and it was ignored. And I think it's time that we listen to them and the people who support them as well.
Do you think Kim Davis helped you win the election?
I don't know that she helped me. I don't know that she hurt me. I mean, I'll leave that. You'd have to ask individual voters. If you look at where we executed this thing from the beginning, it was all on economic issues. I ran this race, my blueprint for a better Kentucky. All of the ideas were about economics, about job creation, about how we build a stronger base of jobs in this state. All of it was about that. And then come summertime, suddenly this issue with Kim Davis and then the issue with Planned Parenthood, both of these moved onto the radar screen, both in Kentucky and beyond, and suddenly social issues were an important part. But guess what? People were already supportive. I mean, the people who support strong Christian values, people who support the very principles that made this nation great, many of those people were already with me. And I think that this just heightened their sense of realization as to the difference between their choices in this governor's race.
You also said last week that you want to dismantle Kentucky's health care exchange by the end of 2016. That's obviously concerning for thousands that have signed up. So what would your message be for folks who are worried about their health coverage?
Again, depending on what they signed up for, fewer than 2% of people with health care policies in the state use the Connect. 2%. 98% of us buy health care policies outside of the exchange. And interestingly, the majority of those 2% just lost their health care coverage because of the collapse of the Kentucky Health Co-op. So you have this collapse that has forced people into the very same thing that they're fearful of, which is having to go through open enrollment. That's what I'm asking for. We're going to open enroll and transition people to the federal exchange. Most of these folks are right now having to find a new doctor anyway, finding a new health care coverage, finding a new what have you. And unfortunately, every time you find a new plan, sometimes the doctors don't go along with that plan. So folks are already in this because of the collapse of Obamacare. There was an article in the New York Times that actually just came out talking about the fact that all of these plans, of the 23 that were set up, 12 of them have already failed or are collapsing right now. So we're in that same boat. Obamacare is a disaster. You can call it whatever you like. Connect is Obamacare, and it's a disaster. It's not working. And ultimately, why should we as taxpayers pay for it twice? So to those who are concerned, I would simply say this. I hear you. I truly do. I grew up with no health care coverage. I had no health care my entire life until I was an active duty Army officer in my 20s, the first time I ever had health care coverage. So I know that people are fearful and worried and concerned. I hear that. I'm not looking to do anything that's going to upset that apple cart. We will be thoughtful as to how this goes down, but we as taxpayers should not pay for Obamacare twice. We can get at the federal level exchange everything that is offered at the state level exchange, and that's what we'll do.
Richmond Police Officer Daniel Ellis will be laid to rest this week after being killed in the line of duty. Do you have any proposals to make officers safer in the state, and should we be considering adding more troopers or more city police officers across the state?
Well, Officer Ellis, of course, was a Richmond City Police officer, married, his wife Katie and a little boy Luke, 3 years old. Mm-hmm. And it's heartbreaking to me. What can I do as governor? I'll start by respecting our law enforcement. There's an old saying that the fish rots from the head down. And indeed, we've seen the fish rotting from the head down in this country. I don't think our president respects the men and women in uniform of our military or our law enforcement. And I think we've seen a ripple effect of that, where we've now vilified the police. We've made them second guess themselves, the very people that we need to protect and serve us. We don't appreciate what it's like to put on a nation the uniform. I, as a former active duty officer, I do appreciate this. I do think we need to not only pay people commensurate with the risk that they take, but we need to support them. They need the morale to be strong, because we don't need them second guessing themselves when they're chasing down a bank robber, as was the case here. Mm-hmm. We need them to know that we have their back, and we need to have their back. And this is how I intend to govern. We will take care of our law enforcement in the state of Kentucky.
But do you think we need to add more?
I think it's something we're going to look at. I'm not going to commit to what we need to do, but in certain areas we are underserved, frankly.
You said in the past, and this was a big thing, Jack Conway brought up a lot was that your past statements that recipients of Medicaid and Medicare should be drug tested. Is that still your view now, and will you push for that?
I mean, the past statements, most of those were actually made up by Jack Conway. So it's important for people to understand that what I actually said is what we should talk about. And I do believe that for people on Medicaid, the actual welfare component, that we should have random drug testing for some of those folks. I do believe it. I do. Because our law enforcement officers that we were just talking about, these are folks who are randomly drug tested. I was randomly drug tested as an Army officer. We randomly drug test our school bus drivers and everybody else. The people that are paying for welfare are the only people apparently that we think it's appropriate to drug test. I beg to differ. And if you are an able-bodied, working-aged man or woman, I don't frankly think you should be, and you don't have any dependents, I don't frankly think that your expectation should be that society takes care of you. We need people working in this state. And I intend to govern in a way that gives people opportunity and the expectation that they avail themselves of that opportunity. One of the biggest obstacles to people getting from welfare to the working roles is the ability to pass a drug test. Why do we create an environment in which it's safe to experiment with things that might ultimately lead to addiction, and for many does? Why would we want to encourage that kind of behavior? So we need to do it within the confines of what's constitutional, understood. This isn't going to be for everybody. It's going to be random. But it will, I think, help to be a prohibitor of this type of addictive behavior, and it will ultimately be good for all of Kentucky.
Do you still support legalizing medical marijuana?
I do. Again, it would have to be, it's going to be dependent on what that legislation looks like. What is the enabling legislation? Only if, in fact, this is prescribed, as is any other type of drug, if it is distributed in any way similar to other types of drugs, through, you know, prescription drugs, it should be treated exactly the same. If in fact it is, I would sign such legislation. I do think it has medicinal value, that if ultimately the enabling legislation restricts its use and makes sure that it is properly regulated and dispensed, I would support that, yes.
Heroin abuse continues to be a huge and growing problem here in Kentucky. We just did a story last week out of Knox County about hepatitis cases on the rise due to drug abuse. What can we do that we're not doing right now to help curb this problem?
We need to recognize that the root cause of this is economic. It is. And I got poo-pooed by folks for saying that. But why is it that people choose a life of addiction? Nobody wants to become a heroin addict. Nobody. Nobody starts out thinking, gee, I want to be strung out. Nobody does. And once a person becomes addicted, they can't save themselves. 1 in 100,000 can save themselves. Maybe 1 in 1,000. But it's the rare, rare person. They will need a family member or their church or their community, somebody to reach in and intervene. So we've got to say, why is it that people are choosing this path that leads to addiction and now disease that are all related? It's because when we have an environment in which young people, and some not so young, don't have any hope, they have nothing to believe in, there's no expectation of them and no opportunity for them to do for themselves. We've created an environment in which they essentially are a ward of the state. You rob people's dignity when you do that. You take their dignity away, then you take away their humanity. You rob a person of their humanity, and they're going to make inhumane decisions about themselves personally, about those around them. This is the root cause of this issue. We need to address this seriously. I also believe we need to intervene. One of the reasons I want to randomly drug test people who are on Medicaid is because if you can intervene early, you can put people through programs that, frankly, for a fraction of the price monetarily of incarcerating them down the line, you can intervene and you can save people from this terrible, destructive path of addiction. We need to spend more on an ounce of prevention and less on the pound of cure. And we need to recognize the fact that we as a society have a responsibility to take this seriously and look at the root cause.
Let's talk about the SOAR initiative a little bit. You have voiced your support for SOAR in the past. Will you continue to work with Congressman Hal Rogers as much as your predecessor did on the SOAR initiative?
I believe I will. Again, I'm not as completely familiar with everything that my predecessor has done, but I know he's been supportive of it since the beginning. Mm-hmm. I intend to be supportive as well. But I do want to make sure that as we move forward, that we're not just giving people fish, but teaching them to fish. That's what I love about the SOAR initiative as it has thus far unfolded. I went to the very first one back in December of 2013. And I remember being excited by the degree of excitement people had. It was a big think tank and a lot of people kicking around ideas and a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of excitement. And interestingly, a lot of good ideas started to come out of that. And subgroups were set up and people to task forces to study things. What I do not want is another bunch of blue ribbon panels and 5-year studies and all that nonsense that never get acted on. But if people truly are incited to action and then take that action, I will be supportive like nobody has ever been.
Senate President Robert Stivers called your win a, quote, total repudiation of the Democratic Party. You agree with that?
I'll leave that up for the pundits to say. I do have to say one of the funniest lines that I ever heard was, I don't remember who put it, but it was a word someone put out there that said bevindicated, which I thought was a kind of funny play on my name. And so there's everybody has their different takes on this. As I said earlier, and I mean it sincerely, I saw the result as a cry for help from the people of Kentucky. I'm not a political animal. I didn't do this for political glory or whatever the case might be. I did this to make Kentucky the greatest version of ourselves that we can possibly be. This is still my passion. This is still what I intend to do. And so to that end, I hear people, and I'm humbled by it. I truly am humbled by it, and I intend to honor those votes by busting my tail to ensure that we do right by the people of Kentucky.
On election night, you said, "Do not forget we are one Kentucky, black, white, rural, urban." You did not say gay and straight, and many in the gay community are uneasy about a Bevin administration. What can you tell them to put their minds at ease?
Tell them to just listen. Look around. Listen to my entire message. I'm trying to make sure that the boats all rise on the same tide. And if we get distracted by things that, frankly, are less critical to our future success as a state, whatever those things may be, if we don't focus on that which is economic, if we don't figure out how to resolve the pension crisis, if we don't address this expansion of Medicaid that we can't afford to pay for, if we don't address the lack of school choice in this state, if we don't address the lack of right to work legislation or the lack of tort reform or death taxes or any of these other things that frankly make us a less desirable place for people to come and create jobs, which is what we need, then we're going to just get off in the weeds. And I would encourage people, look in my life. Is there anything in my life that would cause them to have any reason to be concerned? Look at the decisions I've made personally and professionally. I've always treated people with respect, with dignity, and with fairness, and I intend to do the same as governor.
Well, let's talk about the state pension program. Obviously an issue you'll have to address. Do you still plan to move teachers to a 401k type program rather than a traditional pension?
Again, I think it's important not to miscommunicate what I have actually called for, and I'm not saying that you are, but many have. And I'm not changing anything for anyone who's a current teacher or for anybody who is a retired teacher in this case, or a state trooper or a highway worker or whatever the case might be. But since you asked specifically about teachers, I do believe that all future hires of any state employee have got to go into a defined contribution plan. No question about it. Demographics do not afford us any other alternative. If we don't do this, those future hires, the current employees, and those already retired will not get what was promised to them. We have a legal obligation, we have a moral obligation for our teachers and others to give them what was promised to them. That's going to cost the taxpayers of Kentucky. I'm committed to finding a way to pay that cost. That has been my commitment. For every current teacher, every retired teacher. For those not yet in, we're going to have to change it. Before we move to defined contribution, for teachers specifically, they need to be able to participate in Social Security. They currently cannot. We're one of 12 states where they're not allowed to. We can change that. Other states have done it. Once we've changed it for teachers, then they too can move to a defined contribution plan. And as for the other employees, that's a moot point. But I do think that we have to, because for teachers specifically, when these programs were set up, we had 7 teachers working for every retiree, then 6, then 5, then 4, then 3. There's now less than 2 teachers working for every retiree. How is it possible if you're making $40,000 a year to be saving for your own retirement, and be paying a $40,000 retirement to somebody else? It's impossible. And anybody who's honest about this knows it's impossible, and it's going to require change for future employees.
How do you plan to bring new industry to this state, specifically here in Eastern Kentucky, where we've lost so many jobs in the last few years?
We have to be seen as taking this seriously. And by seeing, there are many companies that are watching Kentucky for 2 reasons. Number one, would they ever come here? But more critically and sadly, should they leave if they're already here? For all the talk of how do we get more people to come here, we should be just as mindful of how do we keep the people that are here from leaving? Because guess what? They are leaving. And whether it's a, you know, down in Corbin with the CSX jobs, maybe it's 190 here, or maybe up in McGoffin County, another 100 here from Joy Global. You know, maybe it's, you know, up at AK Steel where, you know, 400 some odd were just, you know, given WARN noticing. I mean, we've got up and down the Eastern Corridor, there are people that are fearful. And for good reason. There's a cost to all these things, a ripple effect, but how do we stem it? How do we make ourselves attractive? Get our financial house in order. Fix our pension crisis. Bring labor policies and tax policies and legal policies through tort reform to this state, the likes of which we never have. If we take this seriously, then companies will look at that, because what we have, you couldn't buy at any price. The advantages of our geographic location, our four seasons, none of them too extreme, our abundance of coal and timber and water. Water is the gold of the future, and we have an abundance of it. We've got riverways and roadways that connect through here. We've got logistical hubs of UPS and DHL. We've got many things that make Kentucky the potential magnet for manufacturing in particular. That will benefit all of Kentucky, including Eastern Kentucky. But we have to get our financial house in order. When we do, they will come. They will.
Obviously, you're going to be tackling some very serious issues, and some may not be popular. Are you worried that will lead to just one term in the governor's mansion?
It's the least of my concerns. If we did what needed to be done and Kentucky was better 4 years from now, it wouldn't bother me one iota to be a one-term governor. I would consider it a badge of honor to do things that need to be done that others are afraid to do or unwilling to do for political reasons. I'm trying to change that tenor. There's an old saying that if you chase two rabbits, you won't catch either one of them. And that's the truth. And we've about 20 rabbits to chase, certainly, as you noted. I don't intend to chase them all, but we will chase those little suckers down one at a time. We will catch those rabbits. And when, in fact, we do, this state will be better for it. And I'm looking forward to Kentucky being a better version of itself in the years ahead.
You've also expressed your support for charter schools, right to work law. Talk about those issues and why those are important to you.
Sure. Charter schools are nothing more than they're public schools, but you're removing some of the bureaucracy. You're taking some of the power away from the teachers' union. The teachers' union can pretend to be other than this, but they're not a friend of either the teacher or the student. They're not. They're preserving their own power, and they're trying to protect the status quo. That's not helping Kentucky. It's not helping our students. And frankly, teachers are tired of all the bureaucracy. I do believe in school choice. We're one of seven states in the entire country that has not allowed any competition for public education dollars. That's a mistake. We need to do so. But let's walk before we run. Let's start with public charter schools. They're public schools attended by public school students, taught by public school teachers who are paid with public dollars. They are in the same communities. What we do is remove some of the bureaucracy, some of the regulation, and allow teachers to do what they want to do. Very few teachers are doing it for the money. I don't know any, frankly. There might be a couple. But most of them are doing it because they have a passion to teach young people. They want to make the world better, a child at a time, and they're good at it. We've got a lot of great teachers. I say unleash them and allow them to do what they're able to do. So I am committed to us starting with our failing schools in our failing communities where we're second, third, fourth generations of failure in the same school. We got to admit that we're not doing it right the current way. Stop doubling down on failure. That's why I'm a supporter of charter schools and school choice. As it relates to right-to-work legislation, it's coming to Kentucky whether we want it to or not. We're the only state in the South that does not currently have right-to-work legislation on the books. We're the only one on the entire manufacturing corridor. You look at from Wisconsin and the Canadian border all the way down to the Gulf. The manufacturing corridor of America, we're the buckle of that entire belt. And we're the only non-right-to-work state in that corridor. Fully one-third of Fortune 500 companies have said they will not go to a state or expand in a state that is not a right-to-work state. Why would we want to fish in a pond that's two-thirds the size of everyone else when we're struggling as we are, when we need jobs and opportunity? I don't want to see us continue to do this. We've had a dozen counties now from the bottom up, some of them Democrat-controlled counties down on the border with Tennessee, who are saying we need to have this because the opportunity cost to us is too high. So it is coming, it needs to come. But again, let's figure out which rabbit to chase first. All these things have to be addressed in the years ahead. And I do intend to keep them as close to the front burner as we possibly can.
Do you believe control of the House will change next year? And how important is that for your agenda to have Republicans in control?
Yes, and very. yes, I do think it will change. I think the people have spoken. I mean, you look at that map. 106 out of 120 counties is people saying we want to chart a different direction. And I think that message has been loudly heard by representatives. If you're out there as a Democrat representative, you ought to look very closely at how the people in your district just voted. And if it doesn't sober you, you're not paying attention. People want to be heard. People want opportunity. They want solutions. They want something to believe in that's real and not more political mumbo jumbo. So I do think the House will turn. I intend to help as I'm able. So too does my running mate, Jeanine Hampton. We will help to turn that House in 2016. And that will be very, very helpful for us changing the tone of things in the state and the economic climate, doing the very things that we've just talked about.
One of the big things that Jack Conway hammered you on was not releasing your tax returns. And you have said during the campaign that you would do that after you were elected. So do you still plan to do that?
Interestingly, Jack Conway and the media said that I would do it after being elected. I did not say that. I said that I wasn't going to release my taxes. I said I would consider this after we won. I said, let's get first things first
and
win the election.
You never said you would release them after
nowhere in my wheelhouse of recollection have I said that. But here's the important thing to understand. Why would people want to see them? They want to know that there's no conflict of interest. They want to ensure that there's not something that is self-serving by my service. This is why we have these ethics disclosures. When I'm a publicly paid servant, it's more apropos for people to understand how I'm being compensated, and I appreciate that. But there's a reason why at the state and even the federal level, when people run for president, it is not required. Because when you release your taxes, there's stuff in there too, especially if you happen to be in privately held companies with partners. There's something called a K-1. A K-1 releases the information for that entire company. So in essence, while I'm the one running for office, my partner's information would be put out there for people to see. And that's nobody's business as it relates to them. They didn't ask for that. So I have to be respectful of the other people as well who would be affected by this. My intent is to have full disclosure, to allow people to understand where I am so that there is no conflict. And indeed, people can see that now because every company I own has been disclosed, every position that I have, every level of responsibility I have. I continue to put that forward, and I will continue to do that as well.
So you don't plan on releasing them?
I don't, certainly not retroactively. And as it relates to moving forward, again, let's see if it's germane to anything. If I think it would be helpful to clarify things, then sure. But if, at this point, the commitment that I have always made, and from the very first time I was ever asked this question, everything that I am required to do, I will do. That which I'm not required to, I'll think about, and I'll continue to say the same.
Only a few seconds left. What do you hope is your biggest accomplishment after 1 year in office?
After 1 year in office, I want the House to be controlled by Republicans because that will allow us to start the House being the House of in the legislature. I want us to be able to start to pass these very things that we've been discussing. And I think this will be possible. I think, again, I also want us to have seriously, in addition to the budget cycle, address this pension crisis. It has to happen. We've got to seriously address this pension issue in this state. If by the end of 2016 those two things have been accomplished, we're off to a great start.
All right. We're out of time.
Thank you. Appreciate
Matt, thank you for coming down today. And thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time on Issues and Answers.